Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Would y'all like to stand and worship with us?
You're the Lord of this nation.
much for bringing us back together again today. We just praise your name, Lord. I just pray that you'll be with Danny as he brings your message to us, God. And I just pray that you'll open our ears and hearts for you, Lord. And just shine a light on this place this morning. In your precious name, amen.
Messages of Joseph and Mary, and so when I was studying for this messages today, I looked at the Christmas story from the eyes of those who were around that were looking for a promise. And you think of a few people that were waiting on a promise that had been foretold by the prophets. You see the wise men, that they were studying the stars and they had been told of a promise. And then there's these two other people that were told of that were waiting on a promise that God, the angel of the Lord, had showed them. And these two people, one of them's name is Simon, and the other one is Anna. And so we're going to talk about them this morning. But before we get into that, this week is I was looking on an email I think I got is Christmas letters to Santa. And I chose a few of those that I thought were very humorous, and so I want to read them to you this morning. There's kids a lot of times have hard times waiting on Christmas, and at one time I was that child. Is actually even to this day I can't wait for Christmas morning. Is I have multiple game cameras that I use for my benefit on Christmas. Is I always want to make sure I get the kids' reaction to their presents when they get downstairs. So one Christmas morning I set up like four game cameras in my living room, and so because. There was like bicycles set up in there, and they were younger, and I wanted to get their looks on their face, and so I set up all these game cameras. And so, you know, Dad's probably the biggest kid in our house, and so I woke our kids up at like 5 o'clock in the morning. As I rushed them down the stairs, and all these game cameras were going off, they had more of the look on their face. Look on their face, yeah. So some of you are looking like, this guy is crazy. But when I read these letters, I love this time of year. And one of them, I've got about four of them, I'll read to you. Dear Santa, when you come to my house, there will be cookies and milk for you. But if you're real hungry, you can use our phone and order you a pizza to go. Dear Santa, I want a puppy. I want a playhouse. Thank you. I've been good most of the time. Sometimes I'm wild. This one's from a 4-year-old. He says, Dear Santa, I'll take anything because I haven't been that good this year. This is my favorite. Dear Santa, I'm not going to ask for a lot this year. Here's my list. I want the Etch-N-Sketch animator, 2 packs of number 2 pencils, Crayolas, the fat ones, and my big gift is I want my own color TV. Well, maybe you could drop the pencils. I don't want to be that selfish. Christmas is so often as it's associated with waiting, and the story that we're going to talk about this morning is Simon was promised this Messiah, this the Son of God, Emmanuel, before he was to pass from the flesh and go to where the throne of God is. That God, the angel of the Lord, had come to Simon and promised him. That before he died is that he would see the Messiah. And so we look at Simon as he is waiting, and he's older in his age. He's waiting for this Messiah. And he had heard the promises, and he had read through the laws of God, through the books of Moses. He read all these kids. We're going to start in verse 25. When you get there, say amen. It says, and when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written of the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today. And Father, as you have sent your Son, and Father, that we celebrate his birth this time of year, and Father, that we just ask you that not only that we wait to celebrate that day of Christmas, but Father, that we just ask you that you would comfort us. Father, that you would give us patience, that you would give us peace. Father, that you would show us how to be your messenger. And Father, that we would be able to be movers in this world for you. Father, we would make a ripple, that Father, that we would be the people that you want us to be. And Father, that most of all, that as we come here today, that you would remove us from our own selves. Father, that we would be able to hear your word, and Father, it would go and do as you have sent it to do. And Father, we ask you to help us to get real with you today. Father, we love you, we praise you, and ask these things in Christ's most precious name. Amen. You know, in this time of Christ, that Simon, he was waiting on the Holy One. He was waiting on Christ to be brought to him. And so it says that he was an older gentleman. And he was waiting in the church, in the temple, day after day. And it says that he was a righteous, devout man. And that he was waiting for this comfort. He was waiting for this peace. And you see him say that after he had seen the Messiah, is he says, now I can be offered in peace. Now I can go in peace. Is because now I know that what I've been waiting for, what I have been looking for, it is upon us. And the thing is that in our walk with God is that we as people, we're waiting on this comfort, we're waiting on this peace, we're waiting on that day that we really realize what our purpose is in life, what our purpose is as a Christian. You know, you hear the preachers say is that all the time we preach out of Corinthians is that the body of Christ is made up of many members, and that all members have a function in the body of Christ. And so often, as people sit in their chair, they're like, well, I wonder what my function is. I wonder what it is that I'm supposed to do. I wonder what it is that, you know, because I'm not the preacher, and I just don't feel like I'm the person that stands at the door and greets people. I'm not good at speaking. And a lot of people, they're waiting, and we wait for what our calling is. Well, you know, this Simon, he was waiting for this promise that God had given him, and finally it was here. And that day is that we finally realize what God's purpose is for us. And the thing is that so often, as he tells us what his purpose is for us, is that his purpose is for each and every one of us just to be a minister of reconciliation. Is somebody that is going into this world, somebody that is in your way, your form or fashion, is that you draw people to Christ.
Amen.
Well, we're waiting on this day of celebration, and this is what Simon, he was waiting for this day of celebration. Could you imagine that your entire life that you've been promised that you will be able to see the Messiah in as a child come into the temple to be offered to God and say, this is yours. It says it was a custom that they would come and they would offer sacrifices. Two total turtle doves or two pigeons. It says these were the sacrifices offered to God because this is the firstborn child from his mother. The first. And this was the first of his kind. He never had God have another son to walk on the face of this earth.
Yeah.
Never was before, never was after. This was the only one. Could you imagine coming to church, you're waiting here day after day after day, you're waiting on a promise, and finally, Mary and Joseph come into the church, and they say, okay, here's Jesus. You get to hold him. The Son of God. You get to cuddle him. Yeah. So often is that we think of it the other way, that Jesus needs to cuddle me. I need to be found in Jesus' arms. And Simon was waiting to get to hold the Son of God. Emmanuel. A promise. Could you imagine the comfort that he got that when he received the promise from God that it was there upon him? It's like you pray and pray and pray and pray for something to happen in your life. You pray for comfort, or you pray for peace, or you pray that God provides you a job that you've been asking for, or whatever it is that you've been praying for, and then all of a sudden God says, here it is. How comforting is that to know that your God answers your prayers?
Amen.
Yeah. Here's what you've been praying for. Here's the favor that you've been asking for. Here's the comfort that you've been desiring and that you've been praying for. And then God says that He remembers the promises that He's made for you, that He'd never leave you, He'd never forsake you. And here is the promise that He has given you. Man, it makes you jump for joy. And not just because God has answered your prayers, but because you know God's listening to you.
Amen.
Wow. The Holy Spirit prompted Simon to go to the temple that day. You know, I tell a lot of people at times that you come to church is that you think, you know what, you make plans to come to church on Sunday. This is something you do every week. But God prompted Simon to go to church that day. Go to the temple. He prompted him to go to the temple because something was going to happen. You know, that should be the thing that goes through our mind every day, every time that God prompts us to get up, to go to church, because something sticks to happen. Thomas, I might need you to have an amen slide that you just slam up there real quick, really big. With the anticipation of that, when we come to church, that something is going to happen in my life today when I show up, that the Spirit of God says, we're two or more together, that He is in the midst of them. And the thing that we can learn out of this is that God prompts you to come into the congregation and to forsake not the assembly of yourselves, to come together to worship God. He says, when two or three are gathered in His name, that He is in the midst of us, and that we should have a desire to come to this place, not to be seen by somebody else because, you know, just come to this place. Dad, how'd you get so good looking? That's like, what do you want? Is there nothing? I just like that warm something. But God prompts us in our spirits that there is a desire, there is a hunger to go to the temple of God, to go to church.
Yeah.
And the thing is, when we come to church, is that we should desire to come here to be fed by God.
Amen.
What did Simon, what did he go to the temple for that day? He was going for a promise that God had promised him. Do you think he was fed that day? You better believe it. How many of y'all have ever fed? How many of y'all have ever held an infant and thought immediately, this is joy? Yeah, it's like, wow, this is amazing. God's creation. Could you imagine if that was Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus Christ in the flesh? A promise from God? Is he got to hold him? He got to see this child. He got to bear witness of what God had sent. He sent Jesus from his throne to be born in the flesh, that Jesus would go through everything that we went through. And this is the promise that Simon was waiting on.
Amen.
Being fed. Knowing that he was at the right place at the right time because God said, go there. You know, when you're at the right place at the right time, a few weeks ago, last Sunday, is a young girl, 10-year-old girl, got saved here at church. And she was at the right place at the right time. Not only did we, a couple weeks ago, talk about salvation in the sanctuary, but they also talked about salvation in children's church.
Yeah.
And she wanted to know what it meant to be saved. She wanted to be saved. And so she had questions for the pastor. She didn't want to talk to mommy or daddy. She wanted to talk to that guy that stands up there and knows about salvation. Not that mom and daddy didn't, but apparently the pastor's smarter. I'm not. You can ask my wife. She was at the right place at the right time because God prompted her where to be and when to be there. And that's the thing is these divine appointments that God has for you, what are you missing out on? This is the second thing. What are you missing out on when you show up for that divine appointment and get this, your mind is shut, your ears are closed, and you don't hear and you don't see what God's doing? That's just going through the motions. This morning I got to fill in for the youth class upstairs because I paid him sick and David didn't get in until real late last night. So she asked if I'd fill in. So I get up there and, you know, if you've ever taught a class, you know it takes some preparation and preparation, not preparation age. Preparation. It's kind of silly. Preparation. So I waited up there and I sat down with them. Gotcha. Y'all been around me long enough, I don't get embarrassed, so. James, turn red for me. Sorry. So I get up there and I sit down and we're conversating with all the youth up there, and I look at Kenny and I said, Kenny, what do you want to learn about today? And he said, faithfulness. I said, faithfulness. So I said a real quick prayer of mine, okay, God, in faithfulness. So immediately I went to Revelation chapter 3. Wasn't a part of my sermon today, wasn't even a part of my sermon this afternoon. I didn't plan on it being a part. But when I turned to Revelation chapter 3, I read in there where Jesus is speaking. And he says, I know your works. You have a reputation of being alive. So far, so good, right? I know your works, and you have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. You look good. You act good. But deep down inside, you missed the mark. You know, Simon, man, he didn't pretend to be something he wasn't. He listened to the voice of God. And upon that moment, as he was listening to the voice of God, is that he heard God say, go. Go to a certain place, and I've got something for you. I've got a gift for you when you go to a certain place. And that's what we have to do, is when God gives it, he's got a divine appointment for every one of us. And if we would open our eyes, we'd open our ears, and we would just see what God is doing, we would listen to what is going on around us, that divine appointment is the gift that God has sent us.
Yeah.
We talk about for all have seen it. I asked Emma, I said, how are you doing today? She said, I'm good. Where's Emma at? Yes. Emma, what did I say back to you? I started preaching to you. I said, she said, I'm good. I said, no, you're not. I said, in Romans chapter 3, it says, there's none good, no, not one. She's like, what?
I'm good, I'm not bad.
No, she was like, you know, and Simon, he's the same way, is that he had his faults, he had his hang-ups, but in that moment he listened and he became marveled in what God had done for him. When Joseph and Mary tried, when they came in and they brought Christ, what was said about Christ and the promises that Simon had received, as he became a marveler, as he was filled with wonder and astonished and surprised that the very promises of God had came true. What are we missing in life? What are we, as Christians, what are we missing in that moment of not just the promise that God will never leave you and God will never forsake you, not just the promises that for all who confess and believe in Jesus Christ shall be saved. That is the most important promise that we need to stand on. But the other promises that God has given us is that He's going to clear a path. He's going to make a way. And it says that we will become shakers and movers in this world. It's that we'll do more than we can ever even imagine doing because of what Christ done for us.
Amen.
It's that we're going to do things in this life that are unbelievably spectacular. These are the things that we will do is when we show up for the divine appointments that God has for us. For that moment that when we walk in, that we're waiting for what God is going to do for us. Just as we are waiting to celebrate the birth of Christ. That we're waiting that moment to celebrate Jesus Christ. And that we get to give gifts and that we get to see the joy in people's lives. Is that something that we should be desiring in our lives every day, is to see a joy put in people's lives because of a gift that was given. Back in verse 15, chapter 2, it says, when the angels went away from them, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see the things that was happening, which the Lord has made known to us. God has made known all these things to us, that if we would come together, two or three together, then His name is in the midst of us. He says that if two people lay hold of one thing, that God will make those things happen. These are the promises that God has given to us. That when we earnestly go to the Lord in prayer, it says that we would seek His face, turn from our evil ways, and seek God, seek who He is. It says, then He will hear. He will hear our voices. He will hear our prayers. And it actually goes to the point and says, then He will listen and heal our lands.
Amen. Amen. Cool.
That's 2 Chronicles 7:14, if you want to know that. Become a messenger. This is one thing that is that we have to become a messenger for Christ, is that when we go into this world, that our message that He has given us to go into the world and to teach whatsoever He has taught us, to teach peace, to teach comfort, to show people a joy. You know, you read through Galatians, and the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, temperance. And He says, against these is no such law. You can't do them too much.
Amen.
You can't have too much love. You can't have too much joy. You can't have too much patience. These are the things that God wants you to be producing in this world.
Amen.
I asked the kids this morning in class, I said, okay, so say if we just went to your school or to your work or to your friends and we asked them, okay, tell us what kind of person Justin is. Well, the first thing out of his mouth is, man, he is a faithful Christian. If it went into the workplace, what would be our reputation? What is our reputation? Because our reputation is what we believe in. James says, in the book of James, not this one, in the book of James, sorry, you still on? In the book of James, it says that faith without works is dead. But he says, I will show you my faith. Not by handing you a Bible and saying, here's my faith, this is what I believe in. Yeah, read that. But he says, I will show you my faith by how I live my life.
Yeah.
By what I do and how I do it. I will show you what I believe in by what I do.
Amen. Yeah.
What are we doing? Wednesday night I asked the church. We've been, for 2 weeks we studied the lesson, the church. The facts of church life. You know what I'm saying?
She knew where I was going with that.
And so we started the facts of church life. Wednesday night, we closed that series, and I asked several people, "What if you had to describe the church with one word, what would it be?" And we heard things from love and commitment and forgiveness and grace and family and all different words, just one word that people come up with. And we heard many of these different words. And the question that followed that is the one that really should prick our hearts even this morning. Is what are you doing? Because if the church is not this building, it's not the walls, it's not the floors, it's not the chairs, this is where the church congregates. This is the sanctuary we have dedicated to God to come and worship Him. We are the church. And the church is you, are the church. So if we together are the church as individuals and as the congregation, we are the church, what are you doing to be the church? Are you love? Are you family? Are you forgiveness? Are you grace? When people walk through the doors of this church, do you treat them with what you think the church should be? Simon. Man, he went in steady bank. And while he was there, this couple walks through the door. Did he know who the couple was at first? Did they send the letter and say we was bringing Jesus? No. They came through the doors of the temple and they brought their son to Simon. And the Spirit of God moved in Simon and said, this is him.
Amen.
The one that was promised. Could you imagine if they walked through the temple doors and, you know, where was Jesus from? He was a carpenter's son, and I'm sure they had to travel, and they probably maybe smelled and were dirty, and they walked through the temple, the doors of the temple. Could you imagine if people turned and looked at them and said, you're not good enough to be here. You're not dressed right. You didn't tithe enough money last year. They didn't. They come into the church. They brought the Messiah, Emmanuel, to Simon. Simon took this child, they offered the sacrifices, and he was blessed. Yeah. Simon didn't give up. He didn't say this ain't going to happen. God didn't do it quick enough. He waited for a promise, and the promise was delivered to him. The messengers that we have to be in this world is that God has a promise that he has given us. God has given us the greatest gift that could ever be given. Waiting for this Christmas. One Christmas that y'all heard me probably tell this story before. I was a little older and I've been asking my dad for a four-wheeler for, I don't know, 6 months. About 2 days before Christmas, my dad shows up with his truck, pickup truck, and there's something huge in the back of this pickup truck wrapped in a tarp. He wouldn't let me go look under it, so I'm thinking, I got my four-wheeler. And I kind of get my mean humor sometimes from my dad. So Christmas morning, I get up, I tear through all the gifts that I got, and I don't even remember what all the other gifts were. I just knew that there was a four-wheeler underneath that tarp on that truck. And I asked him, I was like, Dad, can I go look under that tarp now? And he's like, yes, son, go look under that tarp. I rush out there, I throw that tarp back, and it's an engine. For his truck. I was anticipating, I was waiting, I was ready to receive my man. I had plans for that four-wheeler. Man, he's going to go into some kind of trouble that I wasn't going to tell him about, but I was busy. I knew that this plan was going in. I get out there, and it wasn't what Danny. And you know, the thing is, there's so many times that we get to a spot in our lives, and we've told God over and over and over again what we want, how we want it, when we want it, where we want it, and we get to the point where God has something for us. When we get there, we throw back the wrapping paper, the tarp, or the doors of life. And it's not what we told God he was going to give us. And we miss the blessing of what it truly is because we're looking for something for self. The thing is, did you show up this morning looking for something for self that would give you a pleasure, a joy in the world? Or did you show up this morning waiting, anticipating for the message of Christ, of comfort, of peace, of blessedness, of to come into this place and to feel a love that your love, no matter where you've been or what you've done or how you've done, you come to a place that you're in the sanctuary of God where he says that he washes all of your sins away, that he makes you as white as snow, and that as you stand before the throne of God, God is pleased with you because of the decision that you've made in your life. In Ephesians it says that we are not saved by works because man could boast. I can tell you I'm better than you, or you can tell me you're better than me because of what you've done and how you've lived your life. I've been a good person. I've done this and I've done that. But the Bible says that that is not going to do it. It is your faith in Jesus Christ. It is the confession that you have. It is the relationship that you have with Christ.
Yes.
The gift that God has brought to you this morning is for you. When Moses was to go into Egypt, he was to take a message from God to Egypt. Moses said, they're not going to believe me. They're not going to listen to me. We've had the same excuses in life. They're not going to believe I'm a changed person. They knew who I used to be. They know who I was when I was in school, or they knew who I was in my past. I was a failure. I was a fraud. I had sin in my life. I was an alcoholic. I was a drug addict. I was this or I was that. And the thing is that so many of us were wrapped up in the past rather than walking in the freedom that God has given us. He said, guess what, guys? I have freed you from the bondage of your sin, the past. And I've made you free. The gift that I've given you is to make you free. And I can do that. He said that he will do things for us that we can't even imagine that he would do for us.
Yeah.
He says he goes before us and he clears the way that we would have a path to follow. When Jesus says, I am the way, he didn't say you're going to have to do it on your own. He didn't say, you know what, I've saved you, and that's all I'm doing for you. He actually told his disciples to go and to wait for a comforter, a gift, that he will always be there to guide you in your life. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. I want you to think about the message this morning. Waiting for Christmas. A gift. A gift. I want to tell you a story. I want you to listen to this with your... Pay attention. There is a wealthy man who shared a passion for collecting art with his son. They had priceless works of Picasso and Van Gogh and adorning the walls of their family estates. And as winter approached, war engulfed the nation, and the young man left to serve his country. After only a few short weeks, his father received a telegram that his son had been killed in war. Distraught, lonely, the old man faced the upcoming Christmas holidays with anguish and sadness. The joy of the season had vanished with the death of his son. On Christmas morning, a knock at the door awakened the depressed old man. As he walked through the door, the masterpieces of art on the walls only reminded him that his son was not coming home. As he opened the door, he was greeted by a soldier with a large package in his hands who said, I was a friend to your son. I was the one he was rescuing when he died. May I come in for a few moments? I have something to show you. The soldier mentioned that he was an artist and then gave the old man the package, and the paper gave way to reveal a package. In the package was a portrait of the man's son. Though the world would never consider it the work of a genius, the painting featured the young man's face in striking detail. Overcome with emotion, the man hung the portrait over the fireplace, pushing aside millions of dollars worth of art. His task completed, the old man sat in his chair and spent the Christmas gazing at the gift he had been given. The painting of his son soon became his most prized possession, far eclipsing any interest in the pieces of art for which museums around the world clamored. The following spring, the old man passed away. The art world waited and anticipated for an upcoming auction. According to the will of the man, all artworks would be auctioned on Christmas Day, the day he would receive the greatest gift. The day soon arrived, and the art collectors from around the world gathered to bid on some of the world's most spectacular paintings. Dreams would be fulfilled that day. The auction began, and the painting that was not anyone's museum list, it was the painting of the man's son. The auctioneer asked for an opening bid, but the room remained silent. Who opened the bidding with $100? No one spoke. Finally, someone said, who cares about that painting? It's just a picture of his son. Let's move on to the good stuff. The auctioneer responded, no, we have to sell this one first. Who will take the son? Finally, a neighbor of the old man offered $10. And he said, that's all I have. I knew the boy, so I'd like to have that painting. The auctioneer said, going once, going twice. The gavel fell, and he said, sold, and cheers filled the room. Some exclaimed, now we can continue on the real treasures. The auctioneer looked up at the room filled with people and announced that the auction was over. Everyone stunned. Someone spoke up and said, what do you mean it's over? We didn't come here for a painting, someone's son. There are millions of dollars worth of art. What's going on? And the auctioneer replied, it's very simple. According to the will of the Father, whoever takes the son, gets it all. Puts things in perspective, doesn't it? The message is the same this Christmas. Because the Father's love, whoever takes the Son, gets it all. Will you take the Son this Christmas? Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today. And Father, all the treasures of this earth, all the things that go on in our lives, Father, we ask you that you would put in perspective to us the riches of being your child. To being a child of a king, of kings, a child of the Lord of lords, a child of the creator of the heavens and earth. Father, I come to you right now and ask that we as a church, we as the church that is sitting here this morning, Father, you would open our eyes. Father, you would open our ears. And Father, that we would become, we would be your people after your heart. Father, we would be like Simon that would wait and seek that divine appointment, that day that we could stand in your blessedness, that day that we could offer up sacrifices for what you have sent to us. Father, that day of just listening to your voice and allowing it to go into our hearts, our minds, and Father, that you would transform who we are to who you want us to be. Father, I love you so very much. Father, I just pray that we would all walk in your love. I'm going to ask you this morning that if God has spoken to your heart in any way, maybe you just need to go and just fall before his altars today and just say, God, I'm here. I just need to listen to you. Maybe you don't know what that gift of Christ truly is, and today is the day that you truly accept Christ, the Son, that you would get all things that go with it. I'm going to ask you that you would join me at his altars just to lift up a praise to him, for we are his people. Will you join me?
Thank you.
you know, I want to share with you the last passage of this scripture we're talking about today. As Simon said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. And this is the part. This is what we should be longing for. We should be seeking. He says, for my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And the thing is when he said this, he was saying this to Joseph and Mary. Joseph, being awoken from a dream, told him that Mary was going to bear a child. And Mary, that was visited by the angel of the Lord, said that she was going to bear a child. They had both heard from the Lord, and even Mary was confirmed through Elizabeth while she was pregnant. Elizabeth's baby jumped for joy inside of her. But to hear this come from a man that they had never knew and never met, and he was at the temple. And it says in verse 33 is that, and his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. It says, and Simon blessed him and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and the rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own souls also, so that the thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. They marveled, because even Simon, at that moment that Christ was brought to him, Simon confessed and believed in Jesus Christ, to Jesus' mother and father, that Christ, this baby, was his own Savior. Not the many years of studying, not the many years of going to the temple and praying, but this little child, he says, that's my Savior. He's the one that's going to set me free. How awesome to know that God pricks our hearts. He shows us a gift. He shows us a promise, and that we're able to tell all of a salvation that was offered just for you. I'm going to pray with you. And you know, if God's laid something on your heart today, and then after everybody leaves, if you want to hang out, if you need to talk or anything, is, you know, there's several of us that stay after church, is that we are more than willing to stay and just to listen. Maybe just to pray with you. Whatever God's laid on your heart, you know, is that if we don't listen to the Spirit of God, we just let it go in one ear and out the other, you know, we'll miss these simple blessings, and sometimes even the biggest blessings that we could ever have. Let's pray. Lord Father, we come to you today. Father, we thank you so very much for this gift that you have given us on Christmas. Father, that we wouldn't get so caught up in the commercialism of Christmas, but Father, we would focus on who you have given us, a gift of salvation, a gift that we could keep giving, a gift that we could share with all those that we come in contact with. Father, I ask you, I pray that you will help us to go into this world and to share the gift that you have bestowed upon every one of us. Father, we love you. We praise you. We ask these things in Jesus Christ's most precious name. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen.